Hey, this is Evan Marquez, dating coach for smart, strong, success women, and your personal trainer for love. Welcome back to the Love You Podcast, where you can learn everything you need to know about dating, relationships, sex, and men from a man's point of view. But the reason I do these podcasts is not just to hear myself talk, which in and of itself is not that enjoyable. I'm here to interview some other experts, some people who are really great at what they do, people that I like, people that I respect, people whose work I admire. And today I'm bringing you someone very special, someone whose work that I actually know, I've actually read, not just someone who I've seen on TV. Her name is Dr. Diana Kirschner. She's a psychologist, has been a recurring guest on the Today Show, appeared on Oprah, started her own PBS special on love. And that special was about the book that I read that made me fall in love with her. It was called Love in 90 Days. Her latest book is Find Your Soulmate Online in Six Simple Steps. She has created helped thousands of singles deepen their relationships and create lasting love. And her free dating tips and relationship advice can be found on her website, loveinnintydays.com. Without further ado, I want to introduce my friend and colleague, Dr. Diana Kirschner, starring from the Cayman Islands, where she's stashing all of her money. Undoubtedly. Just there to check on her investments. What brings you to the Caymans?
Well, it's gorgeous here. What can I tell you? It's amazing. Anyway, I'm thrilled to be with you. At the same time, I'm in the Caymans. So this is really fantastic.
This is a win-win for all of us, but especially for you.
Yes, yes, I have to admit this. And I'm with my lovey, my husband of many decades, you know, and we're having the best time.
I'm gonna start off the interview in a backwards way. I'm not following a script.
Okay.
How many decades are we talking about?
Well, you know, it's been a number of decades. Let's say it's over three decades.
I don't know why you'd be coy about that. Most people would brag to say we've been together for 37 years, but okay, over three decades.
Yes. And I'm more in love than ever, more in love than ever.
Then how do you have the best vacation ever? Uh-huh. Right, because maybe it's just correlates with me being a father to young kids, but my vacations are getting worse and worse.
Well, see, we're out of that stage, Evan. I'm so thrilled we're out of that stage. So
okay.
We just play in the crystal clear water. We just are like two teenagers. What can I tell you? We're just running around this resort like.
I love it. That's wonderful. And again, I like, we're both relationship optimists, and we try to encourage people. Yes, the thing that you're looking for exists. You can find it. And so I just want to sort of begin for people who don't know you. How did you, what's your 2-minute spiel about how you became you and you started doing this on a larger scale past being a psychologist?
Yeah, well, you know, I was really, when I was born, into a family of girls. There were four girls. I was the fifth daughter born to a family that wanted boys. So I really, and my father didn't even come to the hospital when I was born. He was like, oh, another girl, forget it. So needless to say, I did not feel lovable. I did not feel chosen. I did not feel wanted. And that really interfered with my dating, obviously, with men. And that's how I really learned about these deadly dating patterns, or these dead end dating patterns that we're going to talk about today, because I pretty much experienced all of them. And
30-something years ago.
Yeah, many years ago, but I really did. And so I went on a search, to figure out what love was, what true love was, what lasting love was, and how you get it, how do you get it? And I really studied the research about what works in terms of creating love. And at this point, of course, I've really got tens of thousands of clinical hours of experience, because I have a team of love mentor coaches who work under my supervision by phone and Skype everywhere in the world. So we have so much data on that and how you create self-love and you break those patterns that you find yourself in often over and over and over again. It's like, you're dating somebody, you say, I'm never going to be in this situation again. And then lo and behold, you are. And that's what I call a deadly or dead-end dating pattern.
Deadly sounds a bit hyperbolic. Like, if you're doing this, you will be deceased shortly.
Well, your love possibilities will be deceased. That's the problem.
Okay. So since you've led us there, what are the six deadly dating patterns? I don't even know how to sort of set you up for that, because I'm not familiar. I feel like it'll overlap on stuff I talk about, but I've never labeled it as such. So I'm very curious myself.
Yeah. The first one I call the flame out. And the flame out is, you know, you meet somebody, it's hot, it's amazing, the chemistry is there, you're talking for hours and hours and hours, you wind up in bed, it's amazing, it's incredible, and then, of course, you're left waiting for a text that never comes. Like, because you don't really know each other, you don't know what's really going on at all. And there's a great deal of anxiety and a kind of pull away when you have that much intimacy that rapidly. That's the flame out. The next pattern is crumbs. I call it crumbs, you know, where you're willing to take whatever, you know. We've had women in our program who, let's say, are dating somebody and he doesn't ever introduce them to his family or friends. He doesn't go out with them on weekends. He's only seeing them during the week, or he wants the woman to come over to his house all the time, doesn't take her out. That's a pattern that we would call crumbs. Of course, there are many versions of crumbs, the man who won't commit, that kind of thing. Then there's the I'll make you love me.
That works really well.
Yeah, that, you know, the whole business of, like, you work overtime, you're going to bake the favorite cookies, you're going to get tickets to the playoff game. I mean, we've had wealthy clients, female clients who, I mean, really go overboard. They, you know, they're spending hundreds of dollars on things. Of course, you cannot make anybody love you. Either they love you or they don't. But that is a kind of pattern of, like, working overtime, you're going to make it fabulous. Eventually he's definitely going to see that you're the one.
Let me jump in for a half a second, because, this is probably more my lack of knowledge or understanding. I know I label myself a dating coach for smart, strong, successful women. Do you only work with women as well?
We have 95% women. We have about 5% men.
Why is that?
Well, the truth is that my work was developed for both men and women. But here's what happened when my literary agent actually said to me, I want you to focus your books toward women because they're the people who buy books. And so I said, okay. But the truth is that my work was really developed around both. And you really need to understand both in order to help someone date successfully and have lasting, passionate love. But that's the way they wanted my books to go. And that's the way they were slanted. So, but many men read the books anyway, and then they, you know, they get a lot out of them.
Oh, no, it's more a larger sociological question as to, you know, my observation is men need more help, women ask for more help.
Yeah.
But how much of this is, I mean, you just said, my publisher told me to do this, and so I started to do this. Some of the biggest resistance I get as an advisor to women is, why are you just advising? Why are you telling women what they're doing wrong? What about men? What about men? What about men? And it's a good question in what about men? It's a bad question in people like me feel like we're just serving the marketplace, but is the marketplace being dictated from above? How much can we reach men, right? No more than you could say, I'll make you love me, right? You can't make a guy, how do I make my boyfriend be nicer to me, right?
Right.
So I was just sort of struck by what you said. The female client who works overtime, like, that struck me as a very masculine thing. The the guy who's trying to win her over with his means. I will nice you to death. I will buy you to death. But she's like, I'm not that into you. The fact that you put a female frame around that was really striking to me. And our both of our work is so gendered, it seems out of balance.
Yes. Well, you know, the thing is that you can affect, if someone is in a relationship, if a man is in a relationship with a woman and does care about her and meeting the three criteria that I talk about, in other words, he's meeting the basics, he's on her wavelength, he's crazy about her and willing to grow. So he's in a relationship with her. There are many ways to help a man, even when the woman herself is being mentored. In other words, to help a man rise to the occasion, to help a man grow. We do something called the diamond self work, which is
fine. Yeah, we'll get into that later.
Yeah, but your really lovable, amazing self. And so she can give her boyfriend or husband a diamond self nickname, like Captain Jack, Fantastic Frank, and become actually a growth agent or someone who is, their partner. In very healthy relationships, each partner operates as a growth agent for each other, right? So that is something that's been called the Michelangelo effect, where there's this continuous growth and, helping each other be the best they could be, which is quite different than I'll make you love me, because that pattern is actually a healthy pattern. And it's happening after the commitment. It's after the commitment is there, right?
Yeah. I've got so many more questions, and I want to make sure that we get through your six deadly dating patterns before we take our break. We had the flame out. We had accepting less, which you call crumbs. The concept of I will make you love me. There's three more things that will kill us. What are they?
The hermit. The hermit.
Yeah, hard to find love if you never leave the house.
Yes, and I look at a person who is a workaholic as a hermit.
Sure.
I really, really do. And a lot of women who are very successful, they're constantly on their, they're constantly on their email, they're texting, they're everything, their computer. And there's no room for love. There's absolutely no room for love. And then of course there's the other kind of hermit where you're, let's say you might've been hurt or betrayed or whatever. So you're afraid to try again and you're busy laying around on your couch crying with Ben and Jerry's ice cream, watching, old romantic movies. That's another kind of hermit, or you've been through a contentious divorce, so you're afraid, but for whatever reason, if it's workaholism or fear, if you're in a hermit pattern, you're not going to find love.
Yeah, you're closed off to the possibility of something good happening, and it's just safer to not date.
Exactly. And then we have the not perfect, I'll pass. And a lot of very successful women have not perfect, I'll pass. And, that is, they'll pick up anything that's wrong with the guy. There's one woman in the Love Mentor coaching program who was saying, he has bad table manners. So I feel good about, but he has bad table manners. Or I don't like the way he dresses. Or, he's balding and I really couldn't be with a balding guy. Okay. There is no such thing as perfect love. There's no perfect prince. I like to say, there's only frog princes, right? Who are partly frog, partly prince. And the question is the person willing to grow? Because if they're willing to grow, if they're crazy about you and willing to grow, they can grow into a perfect prince, absolutely perfect prince, right? People can learn table manners.
I don't want to challenge you too much. I would suggest that the healthiest relationships is, it's not that growth is inherently a bad thing. Growth is a good thing, but I don't believe you could have a relationship dependent on someone changing. I will love you if you change your table manners. Otherwise,
you can't.
I'd say let's assume that this guy is the way he's going to be forever, and that he doesn't change. And if he changes, it's a bonus. But you can't have a relationship based on, when we get married, he's suddenly going to be a guy he wasn't in the 2 years we were dating.
Well, one of my criteria for really a perfect guy is willing to grow. It really is willing to grow as a person, willing to grow.
Okay.
So, you know, I mean, I wouldn't make a commitment contingent on him growing in a specific way necessarily. But if he's showing some willingness to be self-observant, you know, to change, to be a better person, that is one of the criteria that
I agree with you in theory and not in practice. it's the same way the perfect man, the perfect man is wealthy enough that you can quit your job. I mean, that would be great. But what percentage of men are,
the research is pretty clear that actually 10% of married couples are in what they call a swan relationship, swan, or they have a growth dynamic in the relationship, and they also are madly in love. And that's been actually shown by fMRI studies.
Sure.
You know, where they put someone who's been married for decades into an fMRI, show them a picture.
Is this the Helen Fisher stuff?
Yes. And their brain lights up in the same way a newlywed's brain lights up.
Sure.
Well, there's, you know, so when we do our work, we're looking at optimal, we're looking at, you know, really going for something really fulfilling. And it's a pretty high percentage, 10% of people who are actually in these living, vibrant kinds of marriages. And so,
all right,
you know, we kind of shoot for the top.
I think that's, if you aim up here and you achieve here, you're still a success.
Yes, exactly. Yes.
There's one more deadly sin. What's your deadly? Is it sloth?
No, it's the grass is greener. The grass is greener. So
yes.
This guy is great. He's wonderful. He's good in bed. He's a professional, but I don't know. Maybe
sure.
There's somebody better. I don't know. Is it really good enough? I'm not sure. The grass is greener, right?
I gotcha.
And that is not a good pattern because
I was a grass is greener guy. So I have great empathy for those people. We're gonna put this on hold. We've got so much to talk about. Such smart stuff here. So spot on and. I think our listeners really appreciate it. My name is Evan Marcatz. This is Dr. Diana Kirschner on the Love You podcast. We will be right back.
Two.
Okay. One. Hey, this is Evan Marcatz back with my special guest, Dr. Diana Kirschner, here on the Love You podcast. There's all the stuff I wanted to say to her during our little break. I figured I would just record it because I find it so stimulating and challenging. Dr. Diana was talking about the swan relationship, and truly everybody should aspire to a swan relationship, right? To be in the top 10% of those really, really happy couples. And she's one of them and I'm one of them. And certainly anything I'm doing here is not to say settle, because that's a bad word. However, I'm struck by like a sort of different definition of reality. The same way we talked about how 90-95% of self-help books are written for women because women are the consumers of them, whether it's societal or not, we're not going to quibble. But when we're aiming for the men who are interested in personal growth, haven't we already restricted ourselves to 5-10% of the population? And that's before we started talking about height, weight, age, income, personality, attachment style, emotional availability, right? Haven't, by insisting on a guy being a personal growth guy, aren't we making it, just amping up how hard it is to find a man? Can't there be a great guy who is not into the work?
Well, you know, the thing about it is the way we define willing to grow is not necessarily the way the woman is working on her work or her personal growth, or she's going to classes or she's reading books. The way we define that is that the guy shows some willingness to be self-reflective, okay? Mm-hmm. So he's willing to be self-reflective. He can tell you what he did wrong in his last relationship, okay? He may have been in therapy. He may be in a 12-step group. He's doing his form, or whatever that is, of self-reflection and some kind of evolution. If we don't sort by that kind of dynamic and the woman is smart and successful, it's not going to last. It's not going to last because she's going to get bored. She's going to get, you know, it can be okay initially, but especially for women who have a lot going on, there needs to be some kind of in-depth exchange, sure. You know, that is about growing as people and growing together and sharing, you know, an exciting future of possibilities in one way or another.
I have a question. Me.
Yes.
Front row. Yes, you. Dr.
The
Kirschner.
The handsome guy in the front row. The handsome guy.
Doctor, where? Dr. Kirschner, my relationship is the opposite dynamic, right?
What, so, you say more?
My relationship is the opposite dynamic. Meaning? So I know it's dangerous to take an anecdote, right, and blow it up into something bigger, because the exception doesn't disprove the rule. But uh-huh. In my relationship, I'm the one who's interested in growth and change, and my wife is not particularly self-reflective. She's really just happy with who she is. Right? And
well, that's wonderful. That's really, really, really wonderful. I mean, you know, my experience.
And so I'm playing devil's advocate, of course.
No, I love it. I love it. My experience has been with couples who are like that. That even the one who is happy and easy-go-lucky or whatever that is, will also go through spurts of personal growth, you know, and it changes all the time. The beauty of it is the reason you can stay madly in love and, you know, really into each other for decades is that there is an ebb and flow. There just is an ebb and flow. One may be into personal growth, or they're handling some kind of personal obstacle, or they're, you know, doing something at work that is particularly challenging. The other one is very happy, you know, maybe they had children and this is their dream and they're living their dream. They're with the kids. They're just totally radiantly happy. And that can go on for 10 years. But then in a certain other point that then switches over, you know, the beauty of a love relationship, it's a living kind, almost like a organism. It has a life of its own. And it's so beautiful to me to see it. And it does vary quite a bit from, you know, from couple to couple. It really, really does.
Yeah, no, I feel like we're on the same page clearly about, because there's what works and there's what doesn't work.
Right.
And when I read your stuff, or I'll read John Gottman's stuff, and I'll be like, it seems almost impossible to argue with any of that. I just think that there's always sort of outliers. And one of the hardest things, because we have a similar clientele, is women saying, I've taken self-help, I've done therapy, I need a guy who is committed to the same thing that I am. And I'm like, I think you should just find a guy who loves you as you are, and is a good partner to you. The idea that it has to be contingent on him believing the same things you believe becomes, the more things you layer on, the more deals that get broken. And it becomes, self-help in and of itself becomes no different than, I don't like the way he dresses.
Yes, it becomes a not perfect, I'll pass. It's an unconscious, not perfect, I'll pass pattern. Where, you know, you feel like, oh, I'm doing the right thing. I want this kind of guy and everything, but it's a subtle, not perfect, I'll pass.
And so how do people break out of these? I mean, we mentioned six different patterns, all of which are overlapping and yet different. Where does one begin to say, hey, I've identified, you said something that I identify with, I want to make a change starting on this podcast. Where do they begin? Uh-oh. Dr. Diana's in suspended animation right now. She's frozen. Her laughter's not frozen, but her face is frozen. Nancy, what are we going to do?
One.
Number one is to actually recognize the pattern, really actually face yourself, look at your history and say, you know, this has been happening to me since such and such an age. I am not going to participate in that anymore. Now, the next step is crucial because quite often people will say, I don't want to be with another alcoholic. I don't want to have another guy who, really not into me, but it's difficult to actually follow through. The next step, that really works is to create a very strong love intention. And that is something we do in the Love Mentor program that is very powerful. Where you decide what you do want. I create a fantastic marriage with wonderful kids and live the life of fulfillment and joy with my soulmate partner, something like that. Let's see, I don't actually see you, Evan. Are you there?
I see you.
Oh, good.
Sorry, I'm here. I see me, I see you.
Oh, good. And so we want
you just didn't recognize me because I'm not interrupting, so.
So we want the love intention, you see. So that's guiding you, right? You can actually look at the love intention, you write it down, and there are many ways that we have that we actually can make an affirmation like that stick, which we probably don't have time to get into, but there are ways to make that stick. Part of the reason we've had so many people be successful in the coaching program is that they were able to clarify and actually manifest their affirmation. The third thing about changing this pattern is to have somebody help you be accountable. And sometimes it can be a really dear girlfriend, right? So you're accountable. It's like, wait a minute, you're doing not perfect, I'll pass. You told me you didn't want to do that. You told me you're going to have a soulmate relationship that's, you know, going to be filled with joy and happiness, you know, or you're doing the hermit thing, you're doing it. And you can have a close friend or you can have a coach. I myself had a love mentor, which is the only reason that I am in a great relationship. I have a love mentor coach because, as I told you, I have virtually all these. At one point or another, you know, I was hiding, I was settling.
How old were you when you figured it out, where the penny dropped and you?
Well, I mean, it was early on. It was fairly early on. But I was very lucky and very graced. I feel very blessed. And that's really the way that's why I kind of give these sessions. You know, I have these coaches working with people all over the world because I want to pay it forward. I really, really want to pay that forward because I just was very graced. And my love mentor helped me accountable, you know, when I was doing these patterns, I really needed help. I really needed help. Sometimes you're your own worst enemy.
I agree. Pretty much always you're your own worst enemy. And I think that's the damage of a victim status, right? If you're a man or a woman and it's like men do X or women do Y and woe is me, and everybody in New York is terrible, and it's impossible to find someone who's commitment-oriented in Los Angeles, and these big sweeping generalizations where things happen to you, like it's raining right now, it's just happening. I don't know how I'm the common denominator in it, and sure, you can't control 50% of the universe, but you can control your actions and reactions.
Yes. So getting beyond that kind of hopelessness, getting beyond sometimes a sense of despair or feeling like you're, you know, kind of terminally unique, like, oh, well, I'm different. Nobody else quite had it as bad as me. My husband cheated on me, left me. You know, we've heard all of these things left me, you know, in debt, you know, and, but it was so many times we've seen that, you know, with the right, spirit, you know, getting yourself up by your bootstraps and then really getting the right input, really getting someone who's in your corner, who helps you believe in love, who helps you believe in yourself, who's kind of like a fairy godmother. We all need fairy godmothers or godfathers, fairy godfathers. Then
yeah, I took that off of my branding, fairy godfather. Yeah. Just it wasn't market testing well, but yes, I think everybody needs structure, knowledge, accountability, and people in the helping professions like yourself are doing right. A great thing. So we're going to come back right after this. We're going to talk about the diamond self-identity, which is an interesting concept. My name is Evan Marquez. This is Dr. Diana Kirschner, and we're on the Love You podcast. We will be right back.
One.
Hey, this is Evan Marquez. My friend, Dr. Diana Kirschner, is my guest here on the Love You podcast, and we're talking about this concept that she developed called a diamond self-identity, as a guy who's pretty big on confidence being the umbrella under which everything falls, right? What would a confident person do here? Do that is largely my philosophy. I want to hear from Dr. Diana. What is this diamond self-identity, and how does it help people overcome their shyness, their fears, and become a better version of themselves?
Yes. Well, you know, the thing about your identity is that it's not fixed in the brain. In other words, when you think I, me, mine, it's not
like... Nancy, we're going to have to cut.
One.
Hey, this is Evan Marquez. I'm back with my guest, Dr. Diana Kirschner, here on the Love You podcast. And earlier, Dr. Diana was talking about the concept of a diamond self-identity. And as someone who is a big believer that confidence is the big umbrella under which all good decision-making takes place, you can't have a good relationship unless you're operating from a place of security and confidence. I really want to hear more about this diamond self-identity, what it means for your self-esteem, your fears, your shyness, and how one can develop this and let it infiltrate your love life and transform it. So, Dr. Diana, what is a diamond self-identity, and how do I go about getting it?
Yes. Well, you know, the interesting thing about identity is that it's not hardwired in the brain. In other words, when you think of I, me, or mine, there's actually a kind of a flow of neural connections in your brain, and it's not hardwired at all. It's almost kind of like a light show. If it was emitting light, it'd be like a changing light show. And the beauty of this is that we can actually go in and affect that and deliberately actually create an identity that gives us confidence, gives us self-esteem, really allows us to be more of who we really are. We have a number of exercises in the love mentoring program to do that. But essentially what you do is you remember a time, where you felt really great about yourself. And, you know, could be very early on. It could be in early childhood even. You build on that, right? You create actually a new name for yourself, which is your diamond self name. So if you don't have very many memories in terms of feeling good about yourself, you can even fantasize or imagine what it might be like to really be confident, et cetera, et cetera. So what you do is you access that and you give yourself a name. So,
are we doing the exercise right now?
If we have time, we could do one of them.
Well, we have a 10 minute segment. I'd love to, okay. What could we do with this in 10 minutes? I want to remove myself from the equation and have you deliver some really useful stuff for anybody who's listening, who All of us, you know, struggle in some regard with self-esteem when it comes to dating and relationships. So,
right, right. Okay, so why don't I run you through one of the basic diamond self exercises? And would you like to do it?
Me? Yes! Sure. Sure.
Okay, so close your eyes. And all of you guys who are watching or listening, except those who are driving, close your eyes.
Smart. That's a good caveat.
We
could all get sued for this podcast.
So I want you to remember a time where you felt lovable and loving, and you felt at home in the world, and you felt really, really good about yourself. And it could be a time when you were very little, it could be a time in young adulthood, or it could be something that you kind of fantasize about and think about what it might be like to feel lovable and loving and confident and at home in the world. Good, very, very good, very good. Okay, so now I want you to imagine that you're looking through your own eyes and see the sights that are there in this scene. And then you can actually give it some music or sounds, some beautiful sounds. It could be a song that reminds you of this time. Good, good, good. And the good feelings. Remember all the good feelings. Yes. Excellent. Excellent. Now make it five times better. Yes. Yes. Beautiful. Five times better. Okay. Yes. Very good. Perfect. Perfect. Okay. So now make it even five times better than that. Yes. Yes. Beautiful. 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 Now this is your diamond self, and you can give your diamond self a name. And some of the names that women have chosen are Beloved Mighty Isis, Amazing Grace, Vivacious Vixen.
Yeah, I'll be using all those.
You could be Captain Jack if you're a guy. Prince Evan. Or goddess of beautiful effulgent light, if you're into a spiritual name. We've had so many different names. Each person is different with their name, and you have fun with this, even if it feels like it's silly or it's outrageously positive. You have fun with this, and you simply go with it, and you have your diamond self name. Good. 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 Very good. Okay, so right now, why don't we open eyes? Yes, and share your name, Evan.
This could easily come off wrong, but I don't mind. I'll explain. My name is Daddy.
Yes, Daddy. Oh my God, that's fantastic.
Yeah, when I was thinking of the purest joy, I'll start crying. It's now. I got a 4-year-old and a 6-year-old, and I leave the office and they're just so excited to see me, and they think the world of me, and I want to bottle it.
Yes. That is so perfect. That is so amazing. And you as Daddy are so amazing. The reason they love you, because I mean, the children, they know, right? And they could be hurt even by this young age and turn away from you. Like I never had Daddy. I never had Daddy as a child. He never said, I love you or hug me or anything. I didn't have Daddy. You know what I'm saying? That is a really, really graced creation. That is such a beautiful, beautiful creation to be that loving, incredible being who is Daddy. You know, I mean, it really, really is. I love it. I just love it. And Yeah, so this is really something that we've done with so many people around the world, and you know, and people find it so helpful because you can actually write down your diamond self name. Like, you know, when I did my PBS special, I had to have a diamond self name because I was terrified. It was very hard. As I, you know,
you now have to tell us what your name is.
Oh,
feel like we're veering on the territory of stripper names here. So
no. It's very hard to do a PBS special because you have to read the teleprompter, act natural, sure. You know, deliver the payoff line into the face camera, watch the time.
It's why I don't do PBS specials anymore. It's, you know, the demands were just too great.
So it was very intimidating. I took one of my love mentor coaches to coach me behind the scenes in the green room for hours, literally for hours, to prepare for it. And my diamond self name was the Radiant Beacon of Loving Guidance.
That's a name. That's almost a Westminster Dog Show name. I mean, that's like a
That's
a big name.
Big name. And so when I came to, you know, out to do the show, it just flowed really beautifully.
Sure.
Really, really. And three people who were sitting in the audience got married.
They're able to get married. Right there in the audience.
Practically. Yeah. But I fell down actually at the end. I kind of dropped down crying. I was so grateful. I was just so grateful because honestly, just as Diana, I don't think I could have done it.
Well, I will say this. I was really, you know, I had no idea where the exercise was going. So that was fun. And we generally don't take time to reflect on these things. We're so busy doing or being that we rarely get back to that place where everything was smooth sailing and you were feeling like $1 million about yourself and you didn't think you could do anything wrong and right, the world was smiling upon you. And so for me, just to be able to, you know, and I'm feeling pretty good in general, for me to be able to access those emotions and bring me to tears in and of itself, that's really powerful. So I want to thank you for that.
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. My pleasure. This has been a gift. This has just been another gift that is amazing. And the thing is for your viewers and listeners, that the fun thing to do is to actually take your diamond self shopping, right? So if you
be dangerous.
So if you are, you know, Amazing Grace or Beloved Mighty Isis, you're going to go and you're going to buy different clothes than you usually buy. You're going to instantly find clothes that actually work with that identity and also buy some jewelry. It doesn't have to be expensive, but you can buy some jewelry that reminds you of your diamond self, you know, symbolic jewelry.
You are actually stimulating the economy here as well. And we're all grateful for that in such turbulent times. We're going to come right back with Dr. Diana Kirschner for one more segment where she's going to talk a little bit about love mentoring. My name is Evan Mark Katz. This is the Love You Podcast. Thank you for being here.
One.
This is Evan Mark Katz. I'm back with my guest, Dr. Diana Kirschner, who's just given me a flood of emotions. And we're looking forward to hearing what she has in store for you. Dr. Diana has a website, Love in 90 Days. She has love mentors around the world who teach what she teaches so she could transform your life. And I just want to help the people who are listening today who found anything powerful or interesting or unique on top of what they already get from me. How could they turn to you to find love in 90 days, which is half the length of time that Love You is. So, I mean, it's, I give them 6 months, but 90 days, it sounds like they're getting a better deal with you.
There's no guarantees.
Oh, okay. I do have a guarantee. That's the difference. So what's the best way for women who want to break their deadly dating patterns, to tap into their diamond self and carry themselves with more confidence and set healthier boundaries. Where do they get started?
Well, you know, I mentioned before that I myself, with this background, you know, where I wasn't really wanted or loved, had a love mentor, and really allowed me to create an amazing marriage. And I have recruited a team that can we start over here?
I suppose so. Nancy, do I have to start over, or can we just have Dr. D kind of pick it up after my question?
2-1
Hey, this is Evan Mark Katz. I'm back with my guest, Dr. Diana Kirschner in the Cayman Islands for part 4 of this week's Love You podcast. And so much interesting stuff so far. And I don't want to go without sort of recapping the things that we've already learned, right? And using it as a leaping off point to what happens next. Because if you're here and you're listening to me, you're familiar with a lot of this stuff conceptually. But when you bring in different experts, specifically people who have a different kind of training and background and history, like Diana, who's an actual psychologist, not just a guy with an opinion, you know, it's a real wonderful supplement that I don't think actually contradicts anything that you would have learned through me or through Love You. So today we learned about the 6 deadly dating patterns. What were they again, if we weren't taking notes at home?
Yes. The flame out. There's the flame out where you're hot and heavy and then it just turns into nothing. There's the crumbs relationship where you feel uneasy, like something's not right. You're not feeling good about yourself. You're just getting crumbs from the guy. You know, there's the I'll make you love me where it's like, oh, if only he would see. I can help him see that this is perfect, that I'm perfect for him. I'll have to help him. You know, he'll realize it. There's the hermit, you know, where you're working all the time, or you're just laying on a couch, upset, you know, you've been hurt, you're, you know, frightened to go out there. There's the not perfect, I'll pass, you know, where it seems like you're meeting guys, but, you know, you may have gone on many dates this year, right? But just not, it's like there are no good men in my town. There's just nobody good. I mean, all men kind of suck, right?
Yeah.
And then finally, it's the grass is greener. Like, hey, this guy's pretty good, right? But there might be something better. I thought I saw somebody, you know, on Facebook who was pretty amazing, blah, 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 you know. So these are patterns that really, really sabotage you when it comes to creating the love that you really, really want. They really can sabotage you. And the first step is identifying your pattern, really identifying your pattern.
What if you have more than one?
Yeah, and many of us have more than one. So you have to really make sure that you're not following any of the patterns. And in order to do that, the secret is to have a love intention. That is an affirmation of what you're creating for yourself. If you're not there for yourself, no one else will be. You have to be there for yourself, period, end of story. So, you know, having a love intention, I have a lasting, passionate love relationship with my soulmate, or I have an amazing, happy marriage with amazing children, you know, whatever that love intention is, you know, really putting your attention on it, not having this kind of attention on what's wrong and feeling like this victim and trapped, but putting your attention on what's going to be right or what you're going to make right for yourself. And then finding an ally to help hold you accountable. That could be a loving friend who's savvy, right? Who says to you, wait a minute, this guy is a crumbs guy. What are you doing with this guy? He's clearly a player. This guy is not, you know, he's not available on weekends. What are you doing with this crumbs guy? If you can't set that up with someone who is a really dear friend and getting a coach who is knowledgeable, who can hold you accountable, who can look at you and see your diamond self. In our Love Mentor coaching program, we always have the women do the diamond self exercise, and the coach always addresses her client with her diamond self name, which is really great. It just totally anchors it in. It's like, dear amazing grace, I feel that this guy that you told me about that I checked on match for you is a player.
He's like, yeah, it would probably make me giggle if my clients referred to me as daddy, but I do.
Well, this is the other way. This is the other way. This is the coach referring to the client.
There's only two people, maybe three, who could call me daddy. But
well, I don't get to call you daddy.
Anyway, back to business. So you have these love mentors. They're holding people accountable. They're seeing them in their best light.
Yes, yes. And I mean, you know, they're incredible. They're the people I would go to if I had a problem in love. And I mentioned earlier, I asked one to actually coach me for my PBS special, and it worked out really, really well. And so, you know, we do have a gift for your listeners and your viewers, which is
Is it chocolate? do you have chocolate?
It's better. Better than chocolate. It's
better than chocolate. This is to be really good.
They can have a free session with one of these love mentors by phone or Skype. All they need to do is go to loveinnineydays.com. That's loveinnineydays.com. Click on the coaching tab and fill out the form. Now, here's the important part. They have to put in Evan sent me on the form. So just put in Evan sent me on the form. The reason being is that sometimes we get inundated with requests for sessions and we turn people away. But if your listeners and viewers write Evan sent me, they will definitely get their session. So
see, I knew there was a point in you following me. It wasn't just that there's free shit. And seriously, I don't offer anything like that. If someone wants to call and talk to me for 40 minutes for free, there's no such thing. So
no.
if you're not already complete with all your Evan stuff, and your Diana has really spoken to you today, I have no doubt she's a woman of the highest integrity, and that the people who are working under her spreading similar messages are going to give you something really valuable. And 40-minute one-on-one for free, you can't get that anywhere else. And the URL you gave me is loveinnineydays.com/dating-coach. Does that work as well?
Yeah, well, that will take you directly to the page, where the form is and where they can fill in Evan sent me. And it's wonderful because they will be able to actually work on their diamond self in that time, or they can work on a couple of deadly dating patterns. They can talk about it, you see. So we've had tremendous results. We had one woman, for example, who after her pre-session was able to get engaged to her boyfriend because she understood what was happening, and the love mentor coach helped her talk about, what she needed, right? The guy stepped up and they got engaged after the one session. We've had tremendous results. So, I'm thrilled to be able to do this, Evan. I told you that, you know, I feel very graced to have what I have, and, I really, really want to pay it forward. It really fills my heart, to tell you the truth.
Oh, and that's amazing. And you can do it from the Cayman Islands, which is,
well, that's the thing. While I play with my lobby.
Well, I'm very grateful to have had you on our show. Again, I've been an admirer of yours for years, and I'm glad to be able to share your work with other people. I sincerely hope that people come take advantage of their love mentor offer. At the very least, pick up a copy of one of your books, which are smart and well written and very, very different from mine. And I mean that in the best possible way. I learned something when I read your stuff, and so I'm confident other people will as well.
Well, I've been thrilled to be with you, and you are really a great, wise helper, and it's amazing what you've created.
Well, thank you very much for being here. Dr. Diana Kirschner, ladies and gentlemen. I am flying high. This is a great podcast as far as I'm concerned, because it touched my heart in a unique way. And I definitely want to encourage you to click on one of the links below, take advantage of what Dr. Diana is offering. My name again is Evan Mark Cass. This is the Love You Podcast. Next week, we're talking about how do you know when it's time to leave him? If you're asking the question, you may already be there. If you enjoy this coaching, if you want to be a part of the Love You Podcast, if you want, if you're an expert, you want to be a guest on the Love You Podcast, go to www.evanmarkcass.com/podcast guest or /podcast expert and fill out an application, and hopefully I'll have an opportunity to work with you live on the phone. Don't forget to subscribe to this podcast on iTunes and YouTube. Follow me on both on Facebook and Twitter. And best of all, I give away more free dating and relationship advice than anybody on the planet. Go to www.evanmarkcass.com. Give me your name and email address, and I will send you free dating and relationship advice until you no longer need free dating and relationship advice. Thank you so much. I will see you again next week on the Love Podcast.